Hello and welcome to the 2013 SEABL Preview Show. My name is Beth Davis and I'm joined today by Rohan Short, our very first guest on our very first preview show for 2013. Welcome, Rohan.
Thanks, Beth. Great to have you here. It's good that the Kerry Packer of the SEABL, Mark Shivers, has put you in the chair this year because he's obviously been looking at the ratings with Ed Rennan sitting there thinking, why are they on the slide? Let's get someone in as beautiful as you in the chair today.
So making me blush.
It's great to have you along.
Oh, look, I'm really excited to be here and I think it's going to be a really good season. We've got a lot to get through in this first show, so I think we should just get straight into it.
Let's do so.
And talk about the season ahead. It's been a big off season for some of the teams. Obviously, the 2012 champions, Albury Wodonga, great season they had last year. A couple of changes within their lineup this year. What do you think their chances are of going a two-peat this year?
Yeah, look, obviously, the departure of their key import, Jasmar Ferguson, is a real interesting topic for us to discuss from the get-go here. Albury, obviously last year I tipped them to not win the grand final, and everywhere I travel around the countryside I get heckled by the fans up there in Albury for not tipping them. But look, you'd have to say they've got the runs on the board. They've given us a lot of respect. They've certainly shown us a lot of that they can play. So we have to show them some respect too and say, well, you know, it's their championship to lose this year, and going back to back is always difficult. But a lot will be judged on their new import and how he goes over the coming weeks. But you know, I certainly think that Albury will be there come season's end.
Absolutely. I think that they've done a really good job of keeping their core players together, and especially in bringing back their other import, Momo Natumba. I hope I've said that right. So I think that they'll definitely be a good chance. 2013, a big year for SEABL teams. More than any other season, I think we've got more NBL players than ever across the league. Obviously, the latest signing, Lucas Walker, just signed with Ballarat last week. Big signing for them.
Huge signing for Ballarat, and an excitement machine, Lucas Walker. As we know, he's been involved in many of the NBL dunk comps and highlight reels over the years, but he's not the only NBL player. Guys like Ben Allen going to Mount Gambier, Brad Hill going to Mount Gambier as well, and Graham Dan, you coming down into Hobart, will obviously bolster their stocks. But you know, we've still got the likes of Nathan Croswell and CJ Messingale and the great man Jeff Dowdell heading to Canberra, who is also one of the great characters of the NBL, and hopefully for Canberra helps to pull them off the bottom of the ladder.
Yeah, it should be a great season. Very exciting players to watch all the way throughout the league. And obviously, these players will take some time to come into their teams and sort of get their systems going, with the NBL season not finishing. I think the last game's on the 24th of March. And then, of course, we do have the final series to go, which still up for grabs. Any teams could still potentially make the last two spots in the finals. So we could see some players not in teams until late April.
Yeah, and it will cause a bit of an upset to unsettled rosters, but you know, we'll soon see those players filter in and we'll get this season underway.
So we're just going to go straight into the season previews now for both conferences, taking a little bit more detail into, first of all, the East Conference, where we of course have Bendigo, Brisbane, Canberra, Dandenong, Frankston, Geelong and Sandringham. Very tough conference this year, looking at their teams on paper.
Yeah, look, obviously Bendigo have made some massive moves with Jasmar Ferguson coming into their lineup, so we could probably see them potentially move into that 1-2 spot after finishing third on the ladder last season. But you know, the standout here for me is still Dandenong. You know, there's a very settled roster there at Dandenong. They've added Owen Ottigy, who's from the Melbourne Tigers at the moment, and Owen being a Dandenong junior as well, formerly of the AIS and an under-19s Australian basketball star. So look, I think that Dandenong have made some really good developments with their roster and they'll hold their position. But the team to beat in this conference, other than Dandenong, is Geelong, who have a star-studded lineup, and I'm just so excited to see Nathan Herbert come back to the Supercats. And I know you're a Supercats fan, so what do you feel that their chances are this year?
Look, I've watched them in quite a few preseason games already and they're looking really settled. They've got their core group of players. Nathan Herbert has just come back seamlessly into the lineup. These are guys that he's been playing with since he was a kid, so he's had no trouble fitting in. And of course, with the addition of Ash Cannon, he's just come in, and even in our preseason games, he's just blown us away. The way he's fitted into the team, a new import as well, obviously, Kamani Barrett injured still with his ACL, so they've brought in Mike Mercer this year. And I'll tell you what, he looks the goods. I think we're going to see some really good highlight reels out of him this year, even just from what we've seen in the practice matches.
So we're really going to debate here who's taking fourth spot in this conference, you know. And last year it was fought out between Frankston and Sandringham. But let's not discount the two other teams, Brisbane and Canberra. Their team's on the improve, but you know, they're certainly going to have to get up to around about 12 or 13 wins, which is a big step up for their rosters this year. But look, for me, I think Sandringham will probably go that next step this year and maybe switch places with Frankston, especially given the coaching changes that have occurred at Frankston over the last 12 months.
Absolutely. I think the addition of John Pichon to Sandringham as well, obviously the 2011 South Conference MVP, I think he's really going to take their team to another level as well. So moving on now to the South Conference with teams Albury-Wodonga, Ballarat, Hobart, Kilsyth, Knox, Mount Gambier, Northwest Tasmania and Nunawading. What do you think the chances of these teams are, and who the top four will be out of this group? A lot of changes in these teams as well.
Yeah, look, and once again, this conference was exciting last year because we had the five teams finish on 16 and 12 and it went down to head-to-head. And look, I think it'll be much the same again. I think all those teams are still in the mix. Not necessarily. I think the talent's a little bit more evenly spread across this conference. And look, we'll start off with Knox. Obviously, they were the front runner team there in last year for a long time. And you know, for me, the change in coaching with Matt Shanahan coming into the role, I think, is a good thing for the Knox Raiders. I think they'll play a far more aggressive defensive style. I think they'll know how to get their own shots out of their offensive set. And I think CJ Massengale will relish the opportunities to play alongside some really good players. I'm keen to see how Greg Page goes, who was a standout for Victoria Metro in the under-20s. Who joins the Knox roster this year. So for me, Knox is a team that I'm excited to watch. But Albury-Wodonga, this is the story that everyone's been talking about. How will they go without Jazz? And I think they'll do fine. I mean, they've got the runs on the board, and I could certainly see them contesting for the title.
I think the YouTube clips from their new import shows that he will definitely make some sort of an impact, but of course we won't know for sure until we get out there on that court.
So the cluster of teams, though, in this second half of this is the interesting question. Which out of these teams has improved? And I can't really say that there is one particular team other than Mount Gambier. I think Mount Gambier at 9-19 last year will be a much better team with the roster that they've assembled this year. They've got some more NBL talent coming in, I think they'll shoot up the roster. And of course, Nunawading, you know, my club, where I've spent most of my time in, it's going to be interesting to see whether they can continue to ride the wave of success that they had winning the conference championship only two years ago.
Well, I think they've got Tommy Greer coming back to Nunawading this year. That's a great addition for them again. He was fantastic for them back in 2010, was the last time he played?
Yeah, look, I'm excited to see Tommy back playing at Nunawading. And for those that know him, he's probably going to be the hardest working player in the SEABL because he is in the NBL. So, you know, look, Nunawading have their unique challenges. They've got an ageing roster and injury plagued them last season. So, you know, if they can stay injury-free and led by the great Shane McDonald in the point guard's position, they'll be a tough team. They'll be roundabouts. But, you know, this conference has certainly seen some improvement in some of the rosters. Kilsyth are certainly a stable roster again, and they certainly pushed off the back half of the year. Ballarat may slide with the change in the coaching a little bit, but, you know, with the addition of Lucas Walker, maybe that makes up the deficit from last year. But this final two spots in this conference could come from any of the teams that are in this side of the draw.
So now we're going to take a look at the round one fixtures. Bendigo with a very tough start facing Knox and Geelong first up. Rohan, what else should we look out for on the fixture in this round one of the SEABL season?
Yeah, obviously the grand final rematch in Albury and Dandenong is the feature match on week one of the SEABL fixture. And I'm excited to see Albury host them up there, get the opportunity to unveil the championship banner in front of the whole crowd. And look, both these teams won't be affected too much by the NBL players coming in and out because, you know, their rosters are fairly stable. So I'm looking forward to that particular matchup. Round one is always important for teams that have doubles and getting off to a good start. So a team like Frankston, for me, is a group that I want to see how they perform with their new import, their new coach, what style of game are they going to put out on the floor, because, you know, they need to get off to a good start in their particular conference.
So, yeah, of course, and Frankston as well, Grant Dennis plays his 400th SEABL game this weekend, which is an absolutely huge achievement for him and for the club.
Yeah, any player that played 400 games in the SEABL, we all need to stand up and applaud, because Grant has been such a great servant to the game and such a wonderful servant to the Frankston Basketball Club. So hopefully they can kickstart their season with a win and maybe two, so that they can get off to the start that they need.
Absolutely. It's going to be a tough ask against Knox and Sandringham, but as you say, you never really know what's going to happen in round one. Teams are still finding their feet. Imports are coming in that haven't played in Australia before. It's always an exciting round.
Yeah, and tough for the tipsters too, especially in those in the SEABL tipping competition. And always try to get off to a good start in the tipping competition, because as you know, Beth, I won it last year.
Well, I might give you a run for your money this year, Rob. We'll have to see how it goes.
Most definitely. Put your money down on the table. Happy to take it from you.
So speaking of tipping, can we get your tips for the All SEABL Championship game and who you think is going to win that, and also your 2013 SEABL MVP for the year?
Look, I'm going to go with Albury, because they're a team that have already proven me wrong, and so they're going to be there. And I also think that a team like Geelong, and I know you'll be happy with this, should get there, given the fact that their roster's looking pretty damn good, and defensively I think they'll be very tough to deal with. So for me, that's who I think. In terms of the MVP, I definitely think Jasmar Ferguson will once again be roundabouts in terms of winning the MVP. But I wouldn't be surprised if his former teammate, Momo, gets up there, because he is going to have a massive year for the Bandits and has a lot to prove, given the fact that his good friend is now at Bendigo.
Absolutely, a bit of a grudge match there. Can't wait to see the Albury-Bendigo game. That'll be a great one. My tip, I think it's going to be, have to go with Geelong. And I'm actually going to say that Knox are going to sneak into the grand final this year. I think we're going to see a Geelong-Knox all SEABL game. MVP is a tough one. I'm actually going to say that John Pichon coming back into the league is going to be right up there. So yep. He's my early tip for the MVP at the moment.
Gee, you've shown your stripes early, haven't you, with the Geelong connections? But no doubt.
I've got to go with the former Geelong player. I can't help it.
Look, no problems.
Well, that's about all that we've got time for here on the very first episode of the 2013 SEABL Preview Show. We've got lots coming up for you this year. Some new segments coming up. We've got a Who Got Next segment featuring some really great upcoming talent in the SEABL. We've got a SEABL shootout. It's going to be very fun, with some three-point shootout competitions between some players and possibly some former players as well. And we have a speed minute where we're going to get our guests to do some on-the-spot questions. All that and more coming up this year. Thanks for having us. Make sure you go to seabl.com.au for all your news, and follow @SEABL on Twitter.